Hello and greetings from Iceland, where things are shaky. So let's dive down to Bárðarbunga hotspot, where we got a magnitude 4.2 earthquake yesterday. Usually, I would not consider it newsworthy subject. We get them every now and then. And Bárðarbunga is reloading after the 2014 eruption and up for something, but we might have to wait for a while though. It is the area to the north of Bárðarbunga that is the wild card now. And only 3 minutes after the earthquake yesterday, we got another earthquake measuring 3.2 by Mount Herðubreið that I have been talking about in my last two updates. So this video is dedicated to the larger picture and includes a sightseeing tour as well. So let's start with the earthquake map and run a little time-lapse before we take off. First, I want you to notice the Grímsvötn caldera. A flood relieved a lot of pressure from the volcano just 2 weeks ago. It didn't lead to an eruption like many expected. We did, however, notice this spike in earthquakes that faded out, but we might have been too quick to write off the possibility of an eruption. Then we have the Askja volcano here, where 35 cm land uplift has been detected due to inflow of magma to the magma chamber under Lake Askja, or enough to lead to a large eruption, according to experts. And the third place to keep in mind before I run the time-lapse is of course the mountain Herðubreið, where most of the action has been recently. So now I'm showing you a 30-day time-lapse, each frame is 24 hours. It's of course not very scientific, only to show you how things have developed, and the last frame shows all the earthquakes accumulated. And note that this graph shows only earthquakes that have been reviewed by experts. It's a priority to do the largest earthquakes first, so there are thousands more unlisted. But we see the outlines. And the reason I'm doing this now is that I was asking in my last video, how does Bárðarbunga connect to all this? Askja and Herðubreið. And during last weekend, I was checking the seismometers quite often, since it's so very obvious that we are looking at something very unusual on the northern part of the plate boundaries and also under the glacier. It was my prediction last January that Grímsvötn would erupt this year, and I will be sticking to that forecast until New Year's Day. This is how Grímsvötn look when I run the time-lapse even faster. I'm also noticing that the earthquake activity seems to have decreased by Lake Askja after this extremely strong activity started by Mount Herðubreið. We can see that when we look at this part of the earthquake map, and when I zoom into Askja and Herðubreið, looking at all earthquakes for the last 30 days, it looks like this. The first earthquake swarm took place here. Most of the action would then move a bit further south, and today, the third cluster is forming here, almost directly under the mountain or where we got the magnitude 3.2 yesterday, 3 minutes after the earthquake in Bárðarbunga. It could be a coincidence, of course. It's not for me to say. I have, however, often asked in my videos, how does Bárðarbunga connect to the Askja volcanic system? And once again, I'm reminding you about the 2014 events when a 40 km long magma dike took off from Bárðarbunga and for a while it was heading toward Askja. So again, I would really like to know something more about the plumbing out there. I also noticed that many of the earthquakes by Herðubreið now are at very little depth. So is it magma on the move? Or might we be moving into a rifting episode? And it's very disappointing that our experts are really not commenting a lot about this. There is, however, a good video on the Geology Hub on YouTube that I'm linking to. They believe that this is more likely tension in the crust, perhaps from the magma chamber by Lake Askja, and it sounds like a logical explanation to me. And again, I must emphasize that I'm not a geologist, but I try to listen to all those who dare to comment, especially if they are experts in this field. My job is more to bring my viewers closer with the things that I do better than the geologists. So now I'm going to offer you to a plate boundary tour like you have never seen Iceland before. And thanks to my subscriber, James, for letting me know about this feature that I've been testing lately using Google Maps. But I need some more practice, of course, so bear with me. Since my plan is to fuse drone footage with Google Earth images. So let's do a sample tour. And notice this well-formed sealed volcano. It is called kollótta dyngja, and we follow them down to those sands until we come to this glacier river that has a spectacular story to tell. And personally, I think this is one of the most remarkable places in Iceland in terms of catastrophic geological events after the end of the Ice Age. And my first full-length documentary might just as well be about this region. Try to imagine 1 million cubic meters of water coming down from Vatnajökull glacier every second. And that was less than 2500 years ago. The river turned into a monster carving out these canyons, making this waterfall look like a friendly little creek by a farmhouse. And further down, try to imagine how it must have looked like when all this water carved out this formation from the footsteps of a shield volcano through layer after layer of lava, revealing the geological history. And still today, we can't even fully understand what happened. But let's move upstream again to a single-lane highway bridge, the road to East Iceland. A new bridge is on the drawing board, but the location is the main problem. We do expect other floods. Like, what will happen if the next eruption in Bárðarbunga will be in the caldera this time? A caldera that is full of ice, up to 800 meters thick. And I'm leaving a link to a video I made about Bárðarbunga. And moving up for a moment, we are now around 100 kilometers to the north from Askja, by the only farmhouse around. And from now I will be following the plate boundaries from here, or one of my favorite parts of the plate boundaries. So we move down again to the bridge, from there to the west, follow the highway toward Mývatn. And here we have the lake. If I were to recommend only one part of the plate boundaries, this would be it. And it's due to all the formations around. Those craters are a part of the Krafla volcanic system that we are approaching now. It is responsible for 29 eruptions since the settlement, the last one in 1985. This whole area is extremely hot, so let's do a freeze frame here. First we zoom down, and this is what we call the ideal bread oven. It is an old tradition around here to bake rye bread in metal boxes, stick them in the ground, and use the free energy. Many find it to be a beautiful tradition, and as for me,
you can live on it, but it tastes like shit.
Not far away from the natural ovens, we have the nature baths, using some of the energy around. It was the Blue Lagoon that led the way, but we see those places pop up all around the country now. But let's move up again, and move closer to a mountain that I covered in a recent video. If you want to see more of it, I'm leaving links for it. But there used to be a sulfur mine here. We find fumaroles, mud pools, and the whole package. So this region is nothing but energy. And in the old days, the sulfur was transferred from here to Húsavík, where it was cleaned with fish oil, and then exported. And I'm quite sure that the workplace didn't smell that good. And we Icelanders were actually never good at this. So those days are long gone. This is a popular tourist spot today, like the whole Mývatn region, and I could spend hours talking about this area, and I never run out of stories or photo subjects. We are however heading further north, so I can make my point about the plate boundaries, but first we fly by Krafla volcano, make a U-turn there, face the south, and swapped to drone view again. Just by the volcano we see this, explosion crater from 1724. That explosion marked the beginning of a series of eruptions that went on for the next 5 years. It was then in 1975 when a rifting episode started, 9 eruptions in total, and we were told that such an event would not occur again for a long, long time. Not in our lifetime. Few earthquakes have been detected here ever since, but we do however see increase, not drastic, but clearly more than last year's. And talking about a rifting episode, take a look at this, my friends. Plate tectonics. Here we come. And I'm getting some help from Google again. The black spots are the lava fields from the last rifting episode. And one of the remarkable things we witnessed then was that the lava came up from one fissure and went down to the next one. A kind of magma recycle. Those eruptions weren't that large, however. And I have heard experts mention similarities between this event and the ongoing episode on the Reykjanes Peninsula. And as we get further north from the lava fields, we see the fracture of the land even better. And it looks like this all the way down to the coast. And we do actually have many other formations on the way that I'm skipping now. This is just an earthquake update with a twist this time, and a practice for me, of course, with this new navigation tool. And if I could afford it, I would be using a helicopter to do those shots, and further down, use a drone. And I might just do it someday. This area is just so worth it. And we are coming closer to the coast now. The farmlands are appearing now, and it was tricky to be a farmer here in 1976. The rifting episode peaked with a magnitude 6.3 earthquake in a village called Kópasker, and I covered it in a recent video I'm linking to, but around here in front of us, the ground subsided and formed this lake. And when I zoomed down to it and into drone footage, it looks like this. It's a good fishing lake today, not very deep though, like 2-3 meters, and I'm not sure if the lake will be there in like 100-200 years. So I'm going up again from the lake to get this view, and it's here, offshore, where we get lots of earthquakes these days. And there we are into the Tjörnes fracture zone, which is a story of its own, and I do already have a video online about it. And a linking to it, of course. Further out, we can see the village Kópasker, and from that town, the plate boundaries are also very visible, like you see here, younger land on the move. We never know where it's going to take us next. So let's go back to the lake and turn south from there. Move upstream, up to the highlands again, over the wasteland by the Glacier River, and all the way back to Herðubreið. Wondering, is it the plate boundaries, or is it magma on the move, like experts have not ruled out, that is causing all those earthquakes there? Or is it just the Askja volcano ready to erupt, giving us a warning? Herðubreið is absolutely the surprise of the year. Most Icelanders don't look at Herðubreið as a volcano. It's just a well-formed mountain that will stay like that forever. And as for Bárðarbunga earthquakes, the seismic activity is slightly higher than last year, but nothing drastic. Or like one expert said yesterday, there is no reason to worry about Bárðarbunga now. It's just the standard unrest. But he didn't say anything about Herðubreið. And as for me, I've been looking at the seismometers here in Iceland for many, many years. Sometimes every day. So I know a bit about the trends. I even slept close by an old-fashioned seismometer as a teenager, working in a farmhouse where the 1976 earthquake occurred, shortly after it. So I grew up with this in a way. And I have the feeling that we are getting into something new up north. Could be a single event like an eruption or a large earthquake. And keep in mind that the last 100 years or so have been very kind to us up north. So I'm looking at the seismometers quite often these days. And just a few evenings ago, an earthquake was shaking me while editing. Earthquake on the Tjörnes fracture zone. And judging from a number of earthquakes that I've felt here in the north the last 3 years, it is so obvious that this is going somewhere, sooner than later, in some form. I'm situated like 60 kilometers from the coast now, where we hardly had any earthquakes while I was growing up. There are, however, massive landslides around that raise all sorts of questions about the past here, like this one, most likely on a fault. But the small science community that exists here has no ability to pursue and study all the geological formations we have. But not to know everything is in a way the exciting part of my journey over the plate boundaries. So finally, I'm reminding you about my online stores and other methods to support my work, since this video was a bit of a sample where I'm taking this part of my channel, or to film the complete plate boundaries by time. And with that, I'm sending you best regards from the Volcano Island, Iceland.